the integration to this beautiful place. So this is my first visit to SRM, but I'm really enjoying. So you have already got a lot of inputs about how to calculate various kinds of spaghettis. Normally, it looks very difficult, like anybody who starts there. When you see there's so many lines crossing many K points and so on, looks very confusing. So I will try to give a brief overview how one can experimentally get to those and give some amount of understanding of various things. Okay? So this is basically aimed to the students. So I'll discuss the technique in detail and show some results, but not too many. If you have any question, you can ask, and I'll of course talk for the time. But I have a habit of crossing the time, so I'll stop by the time. Since this is a technique that I'm showing, so I thought that I should acknowledge all my group members, because they have been contributing immensely from the beginning of my time in Tiana. So these are all graduate students. So these are the ones which are there at present. So they have finished their PhD, and these are postdocs, and they are some junior research fellows. So we do have a lot of people there, and all of them are actually very good and contributed significantly. So I thank them. Okay, so what I will try to present is photoelectron spectroscopy, which is based on photoelectric effect. I'm sure all of you know about it. So photoelectric effect means when you have a sample or material where you put light, the energy of the photon, if it is sufficient or good enough to knock out electrons from the material, so it comes out, which is called photoelectric effect. What we do is that we put a detector and try to find out or analyze those electrons which are coming out. Okay. That's basically the process which is happening. So you have a material, lots of photon comes in, and so normally I'll show you some electronic structure, schematic, whatever you already heard from previous talks. So schematically think that these are various core levels which are not really dispersing in energy, and this is probably the valence band, and this epsilon F or EF is the Fermi energy, which is the highest occupied level. Okay. And these are the all empty states. And then we define EV, which is the vacuum level. So if an electron which has energy such that the energy is higher than EV, then it can come out of the sample. So the separation between EV and EF we define as one factor. Okay, so that's the minimum energy required to emit an electron from the surface. So now we think of that the lots of photons coming in here. So if an electron absorbs this photon, so and the photon energy is h nu, the energy will be elevated by h nu for each of the electrons. Whichever one has energy higher than this vacuum level will come out of this one. And then we try to analyze, okay? In other words, you can say that if you have n electrons in the material, okay, and you putter or you put a photon inside the material, one electron comes out. So this electron which comes out leaves behind the system with n minus one electron, okay? So you use various conservation rules and so on, which I'll come to that soon, to link the energy of this n minus one electron left behind by knowing the energy of the electron which has come out. Okay? So that's the basic principle. So in non-relativistic limit, I don't want to go into this Dirac equation and so on, only few equations, okay? So you have seen many, so just bear with me for few. So now if you know that typical Schrodinger equation is your kinetic energy plus potential energy. Now if you put light, your P will be modified to P plus EA over C, where A is the vector potential, okay? So if you substitute this in this expression, and then the additional terms, comes because of A, we can call it as a perturbation due to the light, okay, which is H prime. So that you can write in this form, and then if you take the commutation of E and A, it looks like this. So now you can see that this has two terms. One is A dot P plus P dot A, another is A square. Now if you calculate the contribution to the energies, the second term divided by first term is very, very small, so we neglect this. So now you take the first term and use this commutation rules. So then you can get the expression which is of this kind. And so following Fermi's golden rule, we can actually write that the transition probability from the initial state where the electron was, there before the perturbation, and the final state would look like this. So this is a matrix element between the initial state and final state and the perturbation term, and you have this Dirac delta function ensures the energy conservation. Now you can see that since the light normally is a transverse wave, okay, so the way it's propagating, the electric and magnetic field vectors are perpendicular to it. So you can safely assume that delta dot A is zero. But of course, in solid things can be different because you have plasmon oscillations and so on. But still, if I assume that that term is actually very small, then you can knock out this term, and the final term that comes out is this. So this is the dipole operator that you use for getting the transition probability. Okay, so that's a very important term when you do parameterized photoemission. Now you use various selection rules, so you know that light has some spin momentum and so on, so you can use them. These are all, I'm sure, you have studied in quantum mechanics. So delta L, L is the azimuthal quantum number, which becomes plus minus 1, ML is 0 for, so if you have circularly polarized light, of course the selection rule is slightly different. I'm not talking about this. So the conservation rules are, so the energy conservation, which ensures that your h nu, the energy that you used due to photon, is the difference between the final state energy and initial state energy, which are shown schematically earlier. So which is nothing but the binding energy, which is defined with respect to the Fermi level. Okay. So in photoemission, we always, whenever we call about binding energy, we assume that your Fermi level is at zero. Okay. So and the kinetic energy is the electron that it gets because of the photoelectric effect, and this is the odd function. So if you add this, so this is basically the energy conservation, which is very easy to get. Momentum conservation, of course, is satisfied. This is the K is the reciprocal lattice vector, which you know in solid, so which is related to the momentum or crystal momentum. So this must be equal to Ki, and of course there is an additional term comes due to the periodicity. You know, various Ohm's class processes are also active. Okay, so because of that, you need to add some G. Okay, but sometimes this G can be zero and so on. Spins, of course, are also conserved, because if you have an upspin electron and you perturb by a photon, when you excite it, the spin remains same because there is no process which splits the spin. Okay, so there can be spin flip processes. Okay, and so there are more complex. So let's ignore that. And of course, the symmetry, which is also conserved. So these are the four things which we call often the quantum numbers of electrons in a solid. Okay, so if you know all these four, you know everything about the electronic structure in a material. And the good thing is that you can experimentally determine them. So I'll come to slowly on how it happens. So let's talk about the symmetry first. Okay. So in a simplistic scenario, assume that this is your sample and the light is coming in this way. So if you have any question, please stop me. And here is your detector. So this is called the photoemission plane. So this is your x-axis, this is the y-axis, and this one is the z-axis, which is the surface normal. So xz-axis is your photoemission plane. Now, if your detector is inside on the plane, so we can assume that, okay, this is an even function. So your final state is an even function, because if you reflect with respect to X-ray plane, it doesn't really change. Okay? So that's the way you assume that it's a hidden function. So now look at this expression, mathematical. Since the detector is on the photoemission plane, so this one has to be hidden. So to get a finite integral value, this whole thing has to be hidden. Now assume that you are looking at the dxy state. Dxy state, which is this along this diagonal like that, the way it is shown here. This is on reflection of this xz plane, it's an odd function. Okay? And so if this is odd, then a dot p has to be odd. So what you do is that you take a polarization of this a, which is perpendicular to this surface, and it's a sinusoidal wave, you know that if it is perpendicular, of course it's an odd function. Okay? So that means that if you have a light which has a polarization perpendicular to the surface, you actually probe dxy or dyz case, because they are the odd functions. But if you take a even function, which is dxz state, that will give you 0, because this one is odd, so odd even gives you odd, so this is even, so it becomes 0, okay? Overall becomes 0. Now if you have a dxz state, you can see that this will contribute only when this pump, the polarization of the light, which is inside the plane of this X-ray, and the X-ray state actually is in this purpose. And so that means that if you use a polarization which is in plane, you can actually probe the DXZ states, other ones will be zero. Okay? So by selecting the light polarization, you can actually find out which electronic states are getting excited. This is a very powerful selection rule by which a lot of people find out the orbital character. You know this dx square minus y square symmetry that people found in two plates superconductors. Actually, it was determined by using the polarization dependence, the different experimental setup. Okay. Now let's talk about the momentum conservation. You see that the electron, so this is your sample, okay, crystal, and it comes out, this is a surface, and it comes out like this. Now, when the electrons which are inside the crystal, they are not really truly free electrons, so because they have to overcome certain bounding potential to come out, okay, because the electrons are bound inside the solid, they cannot really come out. So that we normally call it an inner potential, V0. So that means that the electron which has certain energy inside, when it comes out, since it's overcoming this inner potential, the energy becomes slightly lower or reduced by this inner potential. So now let's see your kinetic energy that we have determined, that is p square by 2m. Okay? So assuming that your final state electron that you have detected is free electron, which is h cross square k square by 2m. And now K is this K wave vector, which has a perpendicular component and parallel component. Now, since this electron is not really experiencing any hurdle in plane or perpendicular to the plane, parallel to the plane, so you'll see that the in-plane component will remain same. Like K parallel inside the solid would be K parallel outside the solid. So only the perpendicular component which is there, which will get affected because of the inner potential. So that gets reduced, so which is simple, like a refraction of light. Okay, so you have light which comes out of a glass and you see it gets refracted because it's the same principle. Okay. So now you know that you are equipped with quite a few informations. So you have this material. And now the light comes and it excites the electron. So this electron, if it ejected like this, so you find out at which angle it comes out. Okay, so this is theta. So with respect to the surface normal. Now, as we know that we determine this angle theta and kinetic energy. And kinetic energy is nothing but this. So you can actually get P along this direction is like this. So K parallel, you can easily find out which is the sine theta component. If this is theta, K parallel is the sine theta component. So which is very neat concept, okay? To find out the perpendicular component, what you have to do? Since the electron which has come out with lower energy than the excitation electron inside the solid, because it had to overcome this inner potential, which is V0. So to get the initial momentum vector along the perpendicular direction, you have to add this V0, okay? So then K perpendicular, actually you get the expression which is like, it's a simple algebra, you can just do it, okay? So now, what I'm saying is that, so if you know the angle at which it comes out, if you know the energy, kinetic energy of the electron at which it comes out, you can find out the momentum in parallel and perpendicular components. So that's the reason this technique is called angle resolved photoemission, because you are resolving the angle at which it comes out. And nowadays, of course, the technique, photoemission technique has become very, very powerful, because you can design a detector where electrons coming out at different angle can be mapped at different points. So you actually get the electron density as a function of theta, continuous function of theta, okay? And you get extremely good energy, angle resolution, and so on. Now there is another point which are, yes?
In the previous slide, why these angles were like this?
Which angles?
The emission. So when you are detecting, it's like parabolic.
Yeah. Okay, so I can tell you that. So electron, it has come out at different angle.
Yeah.
Now we provide, use a electrostatic lens.
Okay.
So it's like a optical lens. It's, the activity is quite similar. So they focuses electrons at this slit. Okay. So here, of course, this angle information is preserved. But they are focused here. Now what we do is that this is a hemisphere. So you have to select energy. What we do is that it's a kind of a capacitor. So you apply a fixed energy so that the electron of that energy can come here. Any electron which has a different energy, they have a different path. So they will get absorbed here or this other. So that's the way you select the energy. Okay, so always most of the photoemission machines nowadays, you will find a big hemisphere, okay, of steel made. So the reason is because of that. Now you can see that the green one which has come out at this angle are focused here, okay? And the red one which has come out here, it has been focused here. So you have a CCD camera here. So you have a camera, and if the electron comes, it makes a spot, you just take a photograph, okay? And then analyze the intensity, okay? So the next point, which is that, for example, you have a solid like this. So this is your surface. And you excite the electron somewhere inside the solid. I mean, classically you can think of. So if the electrons are excited here, when it comes out, it has to undergo, I mean, it can undergo some inelastic collisions. Okay, so it can lose its energy. It's not that all the electrons that you have excited, they will come out of the solid. So only some fraction of them will come out without getting perturbed by other effects. So they are more deep, effect will be much more. So you can say that the escape depth or mean escape depth of these electrons will vary if you have different energy of the electrons that you have excited. And of course, the number of electrons that comes out will depend on how much deep you are looking at. So it's like a simple absorption experiment. So if your I0 epsilon is the intensity of electrons excited at energy epsilon, okay? So when it comes out from a depth x, okay, and at an angle theta, so the emitted intensity will be looking like this, which is reduced by this exponential. It's a simple absorption experiment. Okay? And lambda is the escape depth, and this is the cos theta. So what people have found out that if you use different photon energy to just find out electrons from how much depth it can come out. So that means the mean escape depth. So that you can find out here, it's there, the electron, this is called universal curve, because people have done many experiments on many systems and they really found out how it behaves. And you see that if the kinetic energy is very high, they actually can penetrate to some 20 electrons or so. So the typical XPS, which is 1.5 keV, it can actually look at electrons at a depth of 25 electrons or so. Okay? But if you are doing at a photon energy, say 20 electron volt, then it's much smaller. But if you are doing an experiment at a much lower energy, then what happens, the electron doesn't have enough energy to really give out after collision. So they actually they come out. So then the penetration depth again increases. That's the reason the curve is like this. So you can see that just by varying energy, you can actually change the surface sensitivity of the technique. So that way, you can make the technique very, very surface sensitive, or you can make it bulk sensitive and look at the surface and bulk electronic structure separately. I mean, that's a very, another very important strength of the technique. But of course, it has some other issues that you need to consider. And the surface sensitivity is close to, highest close to around this energy. Okay. Okay. So now if I summarize whatever I said so far, is that you have a sample, you are perturbing that sample by some photons, and you have a detector which looks like this. You are detecting electron kinetic energy and at angle theta at which it comes out. Okay. So basically, you have an N particle system perturbed by H nu. You get N minus 1 particle system behind, and one electron comes out. So you analyze this electron, and using various conservation rules, you actually assume that the property of this will be satisfied by this, of this N minus 1. So we actually get the information about N minus 1 particle system left behind. Okay? It's not necessary that this N minus 1 particle system will be representative of the density of states that you calculate from your calculation. So that's the reason I said it's a N minus 1 particle system, and you often call it a spectral function rather than the density of states. Okay? So now you see that this is the intensity that we detect, and there are so many parameters that you need to worry about when you are calculating or looking at the spectrum. So one is the transition matrix element that I have said, and this actually varies for different states with photon energy significantly. Okay, so if you are at low energy, you are more sensitive to P-like states. If you are at high energy, you are more sensitive to relative sensitivity, but think of D states or F states. So that way, by varying energy, you can actually find out the partial density of states of a particular system. Okay. So this is an important parameter. This one is the resolution function, how accurately you detect your electron, okay, by this instrument. This is the lifetime growth. So you know that your conservation rules that you apply depends on how long your hole is survived in the material. Okay. So that means if it has certain lifetime, you can use Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and find out what would be the uncertainty in your energy, which comes, I mean, you can use a Lorentzian function. So the electron and hole lifetime, that matters a lot. So which gives you some kind of a broadening in your spectrum. So the broadening comes because of this. And of course, this is the surface sensitivity that you also consider. So you need to know all these things along with density of states to interpret your experimental spectrum. Okay? One important thing also you need to know is that this excitation process that you are having, like how long a electron takes to excite from a initial state to the final state. Usually electronic transitions are very, very fast. The time scale is of the order of attosecond. Nowadays people have devised this attosecond lasers and so on, and trying to find out this excitation time scales and so on. It's a very fascinating experiment. Phonon time scale is of the order of femtoseconds and so on. Okay, so but when you are looking at the spectrum, since it's happening very, very quickly, okay, you can use sudden approximation to calculate your spectral functions, which we have studied in quantum mechanics quite a bit valid. Okay, so what you are trying to get is that when you are exciting an electron, it doesn't have enough time to really respond. for the hole like this. So that means that you are getting a local electronic structure wherever you are exciting, and the response function, whatever you get, at a very fast time scale. Okay. So now, whatever I mentioned here, one thing is that this V0. So now, how accurately you can calculate V0? I'm showing you here one example. These are different kind of spaghettis that I was talking about. So this is, don't worry about which material it is. So this is a band structure where you can see this is a gamma point, this is a X point, okay? So these are called high symmetry points. Now you can see that all the bands that they are actually, you find, they bends across this high symmetry point. Like if it was dispersing like this, it comes back. So it bends back. So now, if you know this information, now you do your experimental spectrum. You can see that always this energy bands, the peak position that you get, that's your actually the eigen energy. Okay. So in your calculation, so this peak, you try to trace this peak position where it bends, and you can associate this bending with the bending that you have at high symmetry point. And then immediately you can get an estimate of V0. So you don't really need to assume any parameter when you are calculating. So everything comes actually. Okay. Just for those who don't know the facility, so this is the facility that we have built here in Kiarapa. So that's, we are quite proud of this. And the energy resolution, of course, you get is very, very high. So if you do, say, low energy photon emission, and the resolution is close to 1 millimole. This is the best so far people have achieved. And if you do say XPS and so on, then the energy resolution also is very good, about 300 millimole or so. Now, I just want to tell you different terminologies people use. So if you are students, this is for the students only. So you know that you have heard lots of XPS, RPS, UPS and so on. So I just explain you here what those means. It's essentially the photon emission technique that I have presented so far. Only the namings are depending on the photon energy that you use. If you are using X-ray photon for photon emission, you call it XPS. If you are using ultraviolet photon, like say helium-1, helium-2, or any in between the energy less than 100 electron volt, you call it UPS. Now, of course, you can use synchrotron radiation, so people sometimes call it SRPS, synchrotron radiation potential system. You can use soft X-ray, it can call SXPS. I mean, there are different terminologies are there, so don't worry about the terminology. High resolution, HRPS, angle resolved photon emission is called RPS, spin resolved photon emission, which if I have time, I'll tell you a little bit in detail. Of course, there are other inverse photon emission and OJ. So these are different terminologies which people use. So don't worry about that. It's just basically what you are using for your experiment and you name that. I mean, nowadays HXPS people say, because if you use hard X-ray, so if you want to get a bulk information, so use very high photon energy like 6 keV or 8 kilo electron volt to look at the photon emission spectrum. There, your sensitivity is, of course, very high. The penetration depth, 40 to 50 angstrom. Okay. One more important thing that I want to tell you, if you are doing XPS anywhere, just now I said that the surface sensitivity is very, very high in this technique, like a few angstroms, 10 to 20 angstrom for standard XPS. Okay. So that means that the surface that you are looking at, it has to be spectroscopically clean. If it, anything that you keep in air for 10 raised to minus 6 seconds, okay, this is enough to cover the whole surface on one monolayer of interior. Okay, so that means that the experiments that you are doing, it has to be done in ultra high vacuum. Usually it's 10 raised to minus 10 or minus 11 torr, which is about 10 raised to minus 14 atmosphere pressure. So the vacuum is very, very important. Second thing is that you must clean the sample surface inside the vacuum, okay? So anything that you put inside is not good enough for experiment. So it has to be very, very clean surface, and you can hope that once you clean inside this minus 11 torr vacuum, it can remain clean for a few hours or maybe a day, depending on the material, okay? And the sticking coefficient of the surface. So this is a very, very important thing. Now I'll tell you some examples, okay? So this I'll go through very quickly. So this is the reciprocal lattice of copper, and if you do this experiment at different angles, these are very old data. If you want reference, I can tell you. I forgot to put the reference here. So this is somebody else's one. The copper, this is copper forms in FCC, and you can see that the peak positions at different angle actually goes like this. This is the S band and the D band is looking like this. So the dispersions, and you do the structure calculation of copper, and you can find out that the band dispersions that you get for copper actually matches quite well with the experimental data. As I said, that each peak is actually the eigenstate or eigenenergy for one solution, okay, for each cable. So that way, the trace of this peak as a function of K, which is the different angle that you are getting, okay, so gives you the energy bands. Is that clear? Because if you do experiment at one angle, that corresponds to one K point. And the peak in that spectrum gives you the eigenstate, okay, eigenenergy in your solution. Now, let's look at the experiment on different simple metals like nickel, so copper in the same series, cobalt, iron, and manganese. On interest, yes?
I have a question, a small one. Yeah. So actually, like you said about this humps, no? So
peaks.
Yeah, peaks. So from that you get the gamma point, high symmetry points you get.
No. This peak position is one eigen energy, okay, for a particular K point that we are probing. Now, if the K point corresponds to gamma point, of course you get the corresponding energy at gamma.
Oh, so you can change that.
Of course, that's the thing we are doing. So this zero that you are seeing, the theta equal to zero, correspond to the gamma. So this spectrum is actually corresponding to the gamma, and then you go along the K, so gamma, so if you are looking at gamma X direction, for example here, so you are here at gamma, and you align your crystal in such a way that you look at this gamma X direction. So this is 1 on 0, okay? So that way, that means that this is your spectrum at gamma, and these are all the different K points along that line, okay? Okay. So now, seeing that here you have this A state which is dispersing very nicely, and this one also is dispersing. You go to nickel, the dispersion becomes much less, and in manganese, you see in experiment, you don't see any dispersion. Although you do calculations, band structure like any day DFT, so you'll always find some dispersion. Okay. But in experiment, you don't find why it is so. So that's, I mean, something which we often talk about is the inadequacy of the DFT method, okay? Which is because you know that in DFT, it's an effective single particle method, okay? You are reducing the Hamiltonian to an effective single particle Hamiltonian. So the correlation term, electron-electron repulsion term, is approximate. So it's not treated exactly, and that's one most important point. So that's the reason which I said that when you are looking at a photoemission spectrum, it's not a density of states. Okay, it's a spectral function that you are looking at, which represents the n minus 1 particle system left behind by the electron. Okay. Now there are different methods that has been used. Okay. I think here I have tried to summarize what it is. So you have this initial state where your equation is h psi equal to e psi. Final state you have equation which is something like h psi f equal to e psi f, okay? Now if the electrons, they are non-interacting, okay? So then you can assume that the final state wave functions which will be represented or which will be similar like the initial states, okay? And that actually can be used, or band energy can be used to represent your photoemission spectrum. So basically what I'm trying to say is that your Hn is summation over epsilon I ni, if they are independent particles, which can be written as Hn minus 1 plus epsilon p. So you determine epsilon p and you know epsilon Hn minus 1. Okay. But if the electrons are interacting with each other, so this simple-minded solution or not. So then you need to actually consider the many body effect, which is for electron correlation, and this has been defined in the most simplistic way, which is called Habermas. So I won't talk anything details about it, but just look at it. U is simply this integral, e square by r here, and if this is non-zero, then you can see that this won't work. And in the Habermas model, what it has been done is that you have these two terms. One is this epsilon I, and another is the correlation term. This epsilon I, the first term, which is called the kinetic energy term, contains all the information that you get from DFT. Okay? Of course, I mean, it's a uncorrelated part. In DFT, you do have some correlation, so there is always a discussion going on how to map this uncorrelated energy, which you don't often calculate from various packages or various methods that you use. Because you always have two particle term, which is done under mean field approximation. You use get effective single particle description and use it. So this one is not truly DFT energy, but you can assume that if this is the DFT energy and this is a correction term, okay? And you can try to solve your this equation and get a spectral function. Many people have used many different methods, I'm not going into that. Then you can compare with the experimental spectrum, okay? I don't know if LDA plus U has been talked about or dynamical mean field theory has been talked about, okay, in this book, but this has often been used to interpret the photoemission spectrum. And most often we have seen that this LDA plus U based methods are not really very successful to get the experimental spectrum. So what did you find? That if you use DMFT to take care of the electron correlation part, then actually you get a good representation of the spectral function. I will show you some examples, okay? I think I am going out of time, but anyway. So normally, quite less, but anyway, I'll try to see. So maybe I can then skip this. Okay, so this is the experimental part which was done by Professor Fujimori. This is one of the, most pioneering, or you can say, that when you do photoemission, for example, like YTiO3, LaTiO3, strontium vanadate, vanadium oxide, ReO3, and so on. YTiO3, of course, is an insulator. If you do a simple bulk transport and various other measurements, and of course, if you do band structure calculation, it will give you a density of states which gives you metallic ground state. So most of the cases, you do get a metallic ground state because you have one electron in titanium, and of course, it will give you a partially filled band. But experimentally, you don't get it. Okay, so this one is actually captured quite well theoretically by this DMFT radar, so which we call the lower hour band. And now you go in this series, what you are doing is that you do have one electron in the D band in every case. What you are doing is that you are increasing the effective bandwidth. So that means U over W actually becomes smaller and smaller if you go to this up from down. And you can see that there is a new feature which comes up here, okay, at the final. So normally if you call it, this is as the incoherent feature, this is called coherent feature. Coherent feature is termed because, of course, this one somehow has some coherence with the band structure or DFT results. So always you get a two-peak kind of picture in your photoemission spectrum, which is not really the one that you get theoretically. Even in LDA plus U method or DFT plus U, there are various other methods which are there. They often fail to get this two-peak kind of signal. But if you use DMFT, of course, they do. So there are efforts now that LDA plus DMFT, which many people use, to really capture the photoemission spectrum, okay? Which are the spectral function but not the DMFT. Here, this is another example which is found out. So, which shows that LDA plus DMFT may be a good But one problem, most of the cases, what happens is that if you do LDA, which looks like this, and LDA plus DMFT, they also look like this. So you see the differences are not really very big. Okay? So when you have a multi-orbital system, things are much more complex. So DFT doesn't really matter, but you don't also know whether you need DMFT or not. Because you know that when you are doing experiment, as I said, that there are many other factors like transition matrix element, which you don't really calculate from the calculations, density of states and so on. It's not easy to calculate. And of course, you have other broadening things which are there. Okay. So then there are complexity involved. So what you need to do then, band selective experiment, I mean information, okay, which is possible, which we have done. We found a method by time resolved photo emission, how you can do orbital selective, I mean photo excitation, so that you can get information about that and do the calculations. Okay? So here let me see how much, because I don't have much time here. Maybe I can just give this example. Okay, so this is a calcium iron to arsenic 2, which I mean one of the most hot topics that have been investigated recently, this iron superconductors. So you see that there are three bands which process the Fermi level at gamma point, and so there are two bands. So these are called hole pockets. Why you call hole pocket? Because you know the band which is looking like this. So now if you calculate the Fermi level, okay, the terminology, that's how it comes. So you get a closed contour and it encloses all the k-points which are unoccupied. Okay? So when you look at the Fermi surface, this is the terminology which is used, like whether it's an electron Fermi surface or hole Fermi surface. When you get a Fermi surface which encloses the k-points, which is all occupied, then you call it an electron Fermi surface. And if it is unoccupied, you call it a hole Fermi surface. Okay, so it's very easy to note it here. That's the reason I'm showing here. So if you have an energy band where the Fermi level is pinned to top of the band, okay, maximum, then you see that if you get a contour, like if you draw a circle for the whole kx, ky plane, you will see that it encloses the k points which are inside this point and the gamma point. Okay, and they are above the Fermi level, so they are unoccupied. So that's why you call them as hole pocket. But here, if your band is like this, where the Fermi level is close to the bottom of the band, okay, here you can see that all the points which enclosed by this circle around this are all occupied. Okay, so then you call it an electron pocket. And you can see that there are three hole pockets. They look almost like a cylindrical. These are all band structure results. And of course, electron pockets are here at the corners. So that tells you that they are effectively two-dimensional because the Fermi surface looks cylindrical. So it has very weak KZ dependence. So that's the way it is defined. Now, if you do the experiment, you also, it's not so clear, but I don't want to go into the details also, because, but experimentally, it has been proved that all these Fermi surface that you get, you can actually experimentally find out very easily. One thing which we found out experimentally is that apart from these three bands that crossing the Fermi level, you also have one band which is below the Fermi level, which is extra. Okay. So often the experiment gives you this kind of puzzles or surprises. So why do you get extra band? Because you have 5D orbitals. So three are making three here, DXZ, UYZ, DZX. Okay, and there are two bands here, so the number counts also doesn't match. Okay, then we found that there is a hidden phase inside this material that continues at different bands. So if you have, say, a tetragonal structure, and you can have some, because of some distortion or something, you can have additional order, hidden order that we will talk about, that can give you additional features. Okay, the most interesting thing that I want to tell you, maybe you can look at here. As you know, you must have heard about spin density wave state, charge density wave state. So what happens is that, which Professor Das just talked about, the supercell structure that comes into the picture. So you have this simple lattice periodicity that gives you your reciprocal lattice, okay? But if you have a spin density of state, so where you get additional periodicity because of the spin density? Like if you have an antiferromagnetic lattice, then you see that the simple lattice that you get from crystal structure is not the effective lattice that you have. Because you have upspin and downspin, so they are not same. So you have to go to the next upspin to get the same or symmetric or equivalent point, lattice point, okay? So the lattice periodicity becomes double. So if you go to the reciprocal lattice, so that is inverse of the real lattice, so the minimum zone becomes half, okay? So in this antiferromagnetic lattice. Similarly for spin density wave state, so you will get the, because of the spin moments, the density wave, you have additional periodicity or any big supercell that is active in these lattice. So because of that, your Brillouin zone corresponding to that K vector becomes smaller, okay? So when you look at the energy bands, even if you do band structure, you find that, okay? So you will find that some part of the Fermi surface within the first Brillouin zone itself looks identical in another part of the Fermi surface because you have additional periodicity comes in. This is called nesting, okay? So nesting is something where the Fermi surface looks very identical within the first Brillouin zone. So that comes because of this additional periodicity, okay? And that gives you, I mean, interesting features, like if you have a SDW state and you have a band crossing the Fermi level, that can open up a gap. I'll show you here. So you have a hole pocket here, and you have an electron pocket here, and if these two are nested, so if you go below the magnetic ordering temperature, actually this opens up a SDW gap. Because then what happens at this point, if these two are nested, so this point is equivalent to this point, okay? So all the band structure that you have here and here, they will actually form and overlap with each other. So the effective band structure will be like this. And you know the bands, they won't cross each other. So they will actually open up a gap. Because, I mean, this is a symmetric selection rule that you study in any sort. So this is for SDW gap. And you look at your experiment, this is at 200 Kelvin above magnetic transition temperature, and this is below. And you can see that one band actually shows this Kelvin very clearly. So this is the beauty of this RPS method, that you actually find out the energy bands, you can find out if there is a nesting, so by Fermi surface mapping, you can find out if there is a gap coming up from that and so on. Okay, I won't talk about this, only another thing I maybe will tell you, which is very interesting. Okay, so this one, I'm sure all of you who have studied high temperature superconductors, okay? This is a typical phase diagram. I don't know if you are able to see it or not. Normally, any high temperature superconductor, cuprex, okay? So if you plot the phase diagram, they look like this. So your parent compound is here, which is a Mott insulator. Mott insulator means that it's supposed to be metal from DFT point of view. But if you include electron correlation, then it becomes an insulator. Okay, I mean it gives you insulating ground state. Now you both charge carriers or holes, okay? So it's antiferromagnetic. The antiferromagnetic transition temperature goes to zero, and at a certain hole doping, it shows superconductivity. Okay? And this is the line that represents the TC. And often it is found that around 15 to 20% hole loading, you get maximum TC. Okay. The most important part which is studied is this part, okay, which where the superconductors are supposed to behave like a metal. Normally, these metals are supposed to be like, and they should follow family distribution functions. So typical thing that we expect, they are supposed to be Fermi liquid, okay, but the reality is very, very different, okay? So they somehow show additional order or additional things, strange things, okay? So sometimes they are called strange metals, sometimes they are called, I mean, very, very different. So only materials in this region, they are Fermi liquid. And these are all non-Fermi liquid. And one observation I'll just tell you why they are so specifically interesting. I take a nuclear superconductor where Tc is about 90 Kelvin, and I do a experiment, photo emission experiment at 40 Kelvin and 140 Kelvin. Okay? This is oil above the Tc, and this is oil below Tc. Okay? And then what I have done, this is your zero of energy, of Fermi energy, and people have symmetrized the data. Symmetrized means that you plot your photo emission spectrum as a function of energy, and then again plot it as a function of minus energy, okay, and then add them together. Okay, it's the simple Ix plus I minus x. Okay, so that's the simple thing. And that way what is great is that you can get rid of the Fermi Dirac function induced this drop in the density of states. So, and you get some representation of spectral function. These are a lot of problems, okay, but you assume that this is a representation of spectral function. Now you see that if you are here, so which is called the, so this is your, you can say the reciprocal like point. So at this point, which is called node, and this one is called antinode. Okay. Node is the point where you have a quasi-particle peak, okay, and you go to the antinode where you have a gap, superconducting gap. Now if I plot this gap as a function of k, you can see that the gap actually functions goes to, I think this is k. Okay. Anyway, let's look at this. So you have no gap at this node point, okay, and you go towards the antinode and the gap appears. Okay. That's the way, and the gap is maximum at, say, antinode. That's the reason it's called a D-wave kind of a D-symmetry. So like typical D-experiment or I-square orbital of this kind of property. Now you do the same experiment at 140 Kelvin, you can see that this gap is supposed to have vanished because you have a superconductivity is lost at 90 Kelvin itself. Okay, there shouldn't be a superconducting gap. But still you see that there are some gaps at some K points. And of course, now you have a larger number of K points while you have superconductivity, no gap. Okay. So that means that your whole Fermi surface that has been shown here, it's not really a simple matter. Normally, what happens that Fermi surface, think of, I mean, geometrically, a Fermi surface is an enclosed volume. Okay? It can have different shape, it doesn't matter. Now, it can be sphere, it can be cylinder, or it can be anything of that. Now, you take a projection on any plane. Okay, it should be a closed contour. Normally, any Fermi surface that you do experiment or you do find out, it should be a closed contour. Okay? I mean, that's the way you can simply think of. But if I try to plot these points, that the K points where you have the spectral function is actually allowed or you don't have gap, and the other ones where you have gap, so the Fermi surface looks like this. That you have some area, I don't know, somehow the colors are not coming, where you have gap and you have some area where you have no gap. Okay. So it looks like an arc or incomplete or not closed contour, which is very unusual and possible. Okay. So this is, this phase is called pseudo gap phase, and you increase temperature and beyond this line the pseudo gap phase disappears. Okay. So within that, so this is a strange phase which has been studied extensively for last 3 decades, okay? There's no solution yet. Because you don't really simply understand how can you have a Fermi surface which is not closed, okay? Or if there is anything else which is missing. This is one of the most important thing which came out because, I mean, it has become such a big, because of this powerful technique, that will take another lecture, I think. But I think I'll stop here. And I mean, there are many things, like for example, this topological insulators. I wanted to show a little bit of that, but I think we'll talk later. So which has become, because you need this time reversal symmetry and so on, that you can beautifully prove by using an application symmetry. Anyway, thank you.
So thank you, and the session is open.
But the initial part that the probing using incident radiation, the surface probing, so that the surface and bulk that depends on the energy of the incident radiation. So is it possible to probe simultaneously the surface and the bulk?
you are actually getting the spectral function, which is a combined and sum of the surface electronic structure and bath. Okay. So you are essentially probing the whole thing. Because you put some light and some electron comes out, it can come out from anywhere. Isn't it? You cannot restrict them. So electrons are coming out, so at each energy, you get some contribution of surface, some contribution of bulk. Now what you can do is that if you want to extract surface and bulk, so you do take another energy, okay, and take different contribution of surface, different contribution of bulk, and you can just solve the problem. So you have one known equation, and you just solve it, you get surface and bulk.
So that's how we can get the surface states.
Yes. Or surface and bulk later.
I have one more question. You mentioned that depending on the orientation of the detector, we can get the parity, I mean, we can get the, yeah. So in that way, we can get the parity of the band also.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So
that's the way to actually detect.
Okay. So another one, last one. So you mentioned about the spin density wave gap at the Fermi, right at the Fermi level. So what about if this kind of feature is observed much or near about the Fermi level, below or above the, what is the implication?
Yeah. So if it is below, you of course can get it from photo emission. Mm. But if it is above, like unoccupied state, then photo emission cannot get it. Because you are knocking out electrons. So wherever electrons are there, you can knock out from them. So you get only occupied part of the electron structure from photo emission. But if you have a gap in the unoccupied part, you have to do inverse potential.
Okay. Okay. Actually, my question is, what is the implication of if that happens in below the Fermi level? Is there any, I mean, similar to the spin density gap at Fermi level, and similar kind of implication or something like
that? The thing is that if you have it at the Fermi level, there is a lowering of energy, because all the electrons which are there at the Fermi level, their energy gets, because you have a gap, no? So their energy gets lower. I mean, simply you can think of semi-classically. So if you add up all the energies, it's lower than the non-spin density state, right? So that way it happens, but if your gap is at a much below in the occupied part, this energy lowering doesn't go on. Okay, because the total sum of the energy will remain almost similar. But if you have a density, of course you will have a gap which you can see in your experimental spectra. Real implication, I don't know, I mean, how it will happen. I mean, I have seen that many materials, for example, people have been talking about in iron, the superconductors, for example. So there, you know, people talk about like you have one phase, like tetragonal phase, then it goes to autonomic phase, which is spin density wave state, and then it goes to again tetragonal, some re-entrant phase transition that we talk about, which sometimes opens up gap. It might change, renormalize the energy little bit, so which gives you downstream, I mean lower energy. So that people have to look at the bulk studies and see if it has any information.
The last question, thank you, sir.
Okay. And can you explain once again what is the spin density?
Oh, spin density wave.
The charge density wave.
You know anti-ferromagnet? So anti-ferromagnet is that you have a magnetic moment at one side up, and the next side maybe, the simplest way is down. And the next side is up, like that. So you can take that also, you can consider that also is a density wave, where spin density, here is up, here is down, here is up. So you can have this periodicity, which is much larger than this lattice periodicity, or towards lattice periodicity.
So in the case
so
of
where the density of spin is high and gradually it goes down, for some complex reason, it goes down again and it comes up. Right?
So for ferromagnetism case, I will not say that ferromagnetic case. Is
the
spin density case or not?
No. Ferromagnetic means that all the spins are aligned. So all the sides are equal. Okay. So it will only happen when you have an anti-ferromagnetic
charge density.
Charge density, of course, that's the regret to lattice distortion. Okay, so you have a uniform lattice where, say, for example, any atom, any lattice you can take. So you have the sodium, other sodium like that. But for some reason, which is often you might have heard about Jankela distortions and so on. I mean, lattice you may have distortions where the two atoms can come closer somewhere and at some places they are slightly far away. So if you look at the effective charge density, it shows a density wave kind of distribution. Okay. So the lattice periodicity that you have in an undistorted lattice, whatever you have, it's different from that.
So this antiferromagnetism which we get is also due to snaking property or?
Yeah, you can call it a, I mean, there also you have a density wave kind of scenario. So you have a super cell, so you get a front surface which is nested.
Okay, so let us thank the speaker, Professor Mahanti. Fantastic job.